wife of a king, mother of a king. Queen Hetepheris was the great lady of the old kingdom. Her tomb furniture made of wood encased with pure gold has the beauty of the gentle curve and the serene straight line. Hetepheris, mother of Cheops, led a long life of imperial splendor. Fine linen was hung from the bed canopy, suspended from these slender hooks. The Dowager Queen often rode about the palace grounds in her royal carrying chair. Letters of gold spell out the legend, Mother of the King of Upper and Lower Egypt, follower of Horus, guide of the ruler, favorite lady whose every word is done for her, daughter of his body, Hetepheris. Out of the living rock was lost in ancient times. The body was swallowed by the sea of sand, and the huge head was worshipped as the god of dawn and thought to hold the answer to the mystery of life itself. It was believed that someday the stone lips would part and this inscrutable monster give the answers to the problems of mankind. Look on my works, ye mighty, and despair. Nothing beside remains. Round the decay of that colossal wreck, boundless and bare, the lone and level sands stretch far away. Proud head of Khafre, the son of Cheops and builder of the second pyramid, keeps eternal vigil over the valley of the Nile. Much of the royal sculpture is formal and stylized, but in these portrait heads, we see the true face of ancient Egypt, curiously like the mingled races of our own time. These portraits of nobles were placed in the tombs to assure a permanent home for the ka, or spirit, in case the mummy was destroyed. During the reign of Cheops and his immediate descendants, sculpture in the round reached its peak and was never again surpassed in Egyptian art. Diorite, one of the hardest materials, here holds King Khafre in regal dignity. Many gods of ancient Egypt manifested themselves in animal form. The hawk god, Horus, was destined to remain a chief deity up to the Christian era. He represented the forces of good against evil. In the 5th dynasty, the governors of the individual provinces began to assume some of Pharaoh's control. Under Pepi I of the 6th dynasty, this process continued. Pepi II began his reign on the lap of his queen mother and ruled for 94 years. Toward the end of his fabulous regime, political disintegration set in. Egyptian fought Egyptian, and the local governors no longer held allegiance to the crown. Egypt became a series of small states struggling against themselves. Thus was brought to a close the great glory of the old kingdom, which had lasted nearly 1,000 years. For 2 centuries, the country was disorganized. In the 11th dynasty, the river was again a unifying factor. The lands along the Nile became one again, and commerce flourished. The gods of Upper and Lower Egypt bind together the lotus and papyrus, symbols of the two lands. Mentuhotep II regained firm control and ushered in the Middle Kingdom. Was the rebirth of formal art in tomb decoration of great beauty. On her limestone sarcophagus, Princess Kawit has her hair dressed by an attendant. A polished bronze mirror reflects her vanity. Provisions are made for life in the hereafter. While the cow is milked, the calf is denied, and the mother sheds a formal tear. The eyes of the dead stare into the world of the living. The 12th dynasty continued this period of prosperity and conquest. Sesostris I ruled the two lands in 1960 BC. The names of Egyptian rulers are enclosed in this characteristic oval, the royal cartouche of Sesostris I. Royal jewelry reached a high standard of excellence. Magnificent monuments were erected during his reign, such as this shrine dedicated to the god Amun. Mentuhotep III carried out great irrigation projects in the Fayum. The fury of the unchecked waters during inundation had to be controlled. A great reservoir and a complicated series of canals were excavated. No longer was the Nile a fickle monster, but the controlled servant of the people who dwelt along its banks. This grand-scale project was carried to fulfillment with this simple type of hole, and countless tons of earth were moved in tiny baskets. The nobles decorated the portals and facades of their tombs with sunken relief. The colorful birds of Beni Hassan fly through the heavens in the afterworld as in life. In the ensuing millennia, man will spend his years in struggle and strife. Millions of humans will fall before the wrath of their brethren. The forces of nature will alter the face of the earth, but the wild creatures remain unchanged. The birds of Benny Hassan fly in the skies of today. The artist delicately suggests the hippo's swamp habitat. Wooden bedsteads were frequently inlaid with ivory animals. Perhaps the greatest of the monumental works of this period was the slender granite shaft called the obelisk. In the quarries of Aswan, we wonder at the engineering skill entailed in the removal of huge single pieces of granite from the bedrock. Balls of dolerite or other hard stone were used in the channeling out process. Human hands patiently wielded these primitive tools to reduce to dust the parts of the rock which had to be removed. This giant shaft would have been the tallest of all obelisks, but a fault was discovered in the quarrying process, and the project was abandoned. This staggering feat of engineering, begun at the quarry, continued on in the journey 400 miles down the Nile, reached its climax when the shaft was proudly raised before the gateway of a great temple. Here indeed, art, craft, and ingenuity combined symbolically with the spirit of man, as this slender shaft of granite points its slim finger at the heavens. The Middle Kingdom met its end in political disintegration and civil war. From the east, the Hyksos swept in with a terrible weapon, the war chariot. For two centuries, Egypt bowed under the yoke of foreign domination. Wrested the horse and the chariot from the invader and turned these instruments of terror back against him. To the east, to the south, the war chariots thundered, and the force of Egyptian arms was felt far into Asia, deep into Nubia. Oblivious to the follies of men, the mighty Nile continued to bring life and strength to the thirsty land of Egypt. 1600 years after Narmer first wore the double crown, Pharaoh Akhmose, with this golden battle axe, began the 18th dynasty. The powerful new kingdom was born. At the capital city of Thebes, the east bank is for the living. Across the river where the sun sets, lies the necropolis, the city of the dead. Against a backdrop of brilliant cliffs, splendid temples and tombs enshrine forever the memory of the leaders of the new kingdom. Natural setting. Hatshepsut, though a woman, ruled as pharaoh. An able administrator, she surrounded herself with a group of powerful men who held the country in firm hands. The goddess Hathor, represented as a cow, yields strength to Hatshepsut. Obviously a woman of dynamic qualities, for her the title of queen was not enough. She declared herself king of Egypt, was depicted wearing male attire, and even the false beard of Pharaoh. She was succeeded by Thutmosis III, whose first act was to wipe out the memory of the woman who had so dominated him. Despite this initial pettiness, Thutmosis went on to become a powerful monarch in his own right. He extended the empire by conquests to the south and north to Palestine and Lebanon. This warrior king personally led his armies in 17 different campaigns. In this delicate marble miniature, Thutmosis makes offering to his gods. His personal valor was supplemented by shrewd tactics. He once introduced his troops into a beleaguered city concealed in sacks, as in the story of Ali Baba. The ladies of his court ate from gold service and kept their perfume in decorated vases. A statuette in solid gold represents Thutmosis III in the likeness of the chief god, Amun, an example of the cult of the divinity of kings. Egypt reached a height of opulence and political importance under this mightiest of empire builders. Not long after the warlike era of Thutmosis came a period of peace and prosperity under Amenhotep III. His name will ever be associated with the colossi of Memnon. Twelve times the height of a man, these huge statues once guarded the entrance to his temple. For 33 centuries, these sentinels of the Theban plain have gazed across the Nile. With sightless eyes, they look to the east, to the land of the dawn, to the glories of Karnak and Luxor.